फ्रेंड्स, वेलकम टू माय यूट्यूब चैनल एसएम लेक्चर सीरीज। योर ओनली स्टॉप टू गेट ऑल द नॉलेज ऑफ फाइनाइट एलिमेंट एनालिसिस, कैडकैम, सीएई एंड मेनी अदर सब्जेक्ट्स। ऑल्सो योर वन स्टॉप डेस्टिनेशन टू लर्न सॉफ्टवेयर्स लाइक सॉलिड वर्क्स, मास्टर कैम, ऑटोडेस्क फ्यूजन 360 एंड मेनी मोर टू कम। प्लीज डू लाइक, शेयर एंड सब्सक्राइब माय चैनल टू स्टे अपडेटेड विद द लेटेस्ट नॉलेज। थैंक यू।
हेलो फ्रेंड्स, टुडे वी विल सी द डिफरेंट वेटेड रेसिडुअल मेथड्स एंड हाउ टू सॉल्व ए गिवन डिफरेंशियल इक्वेशन विथ ऑल दोज वेटेड रेसिडुअल मेथड्स। ओके, so let's get started with this particular differential equation. So it is a second order differential equation, 3d2y by dx square minus dy by dx plus 8 equal to 0 within this given limit, and boundary conditions are essential boundary conditions all pertaining to only primary variable. So y at x equal to 0 is 1, y at x equal to 1 is 2, and we have to identify the value of this differential equation at these primary variable location. So at y at x equal to 0.3 and y at x equal to 0.6. So let's get started. The first thing that we will have to do is assume the approximate function. So let y is equal to, now we know that order of this differential equation is 2, so the polynomial degree will be 2 plus 1, that is 3. So I will be having c0 plus c1x plus c2x square plus c3x square. Now this is going to be my approximate function. I will apply the boundary conditions. So I know that y at x equal to 0 is 1. So on the left hand side I have 1. Now what I will have is c0 plus c1 into 1 plus c2 into 1 square plus c3 into 1 cube. Sorry, not 1, because it is 0 right now. So c1 into 0 plus c2 into 0 square plus c3 into 0 cube. So it's basically all these will get cancelled. I will only have c0 equal to 1. So I found the value of c0, that is 1. So one constant parameter is identified. Now the second boundary condition is y equal to 2 at x equal to 1. So y at x equal to 1 is 2. So on the left hand side I have 2. Now I have already found out c0, so that I will use over here. 1 plus, then what I have here, c1 into 1 plus c2 into 1 square, c2 into 1 square plus c3 into 1 cube. So I can write this as 2 equal to 1 plus c1 plus c2 plus c3. So I will bring everything on one side. I will bring everything on one side and I will write this as c1 equal to, so this 2 minus 1 will be 1, minus c2 minus c3. So that I also found what is c1. Now I will use both of these in this equation. So I will have y is equal to c0 already found to be 1 plus c1 is what, 1 minus c2 minus c3 multiplied by x plus c2x square plus c3x cube. So it turns out to be 1 plus, now I will open the bracket, x minus xc2 minus xc3 plus c2x square plus c3x cube. And if I start combining the terms, what I will have is, I will just write the coefficients term first and all that remaining at the last. So I will have in the bracket x square minus x c2 plus x cube minus x c3, okay, plus x plus 1. Okay, that is what my y is. So this is going to be the approximate function that I eventually derived. I will number it as equation number 1. I will derive this as equation number 1. Now, given this differential equation, okay, I know that it is not gonna be equal to 0 because I am using an approximate method. So I will equate this with R. Okay, I will equate this with R and I will find the value of residue. So in order to do that, I will first have to differentiate this y equation. So I will write dy by dx as something. So it is 2x minus 1 c2 plus 3x square minus 1 c3 plus 1 plus 0. I will again differentiate this, so d2y by dx square is equal to 2c2 plus 6x c3 plus 6x c3. Okay, that will be it. So now I will be attempting to find the residue. So residue R is given by, so I will write this entire differential equation as residue. So it is going to be 3 d2y by dx square plus minus dy by dx, and then I have this plus 8. And I will use these differentials, okay, which we have identified from this approximate function. So what we will do is 3 multiplied by d2y by dx square we found out to be 2c2 plus 6xc3 minus dy by dx is already found out to be 2x minus 1c2 plus 3x square minus 1 c3 plus 1 and then plus 8. So this is what R is. So if I simplify this further, okay, and regroup some of the terms, I will get eventually R as 3 will be done based on the coefficient. So that is c2. So I will first open this bracket. So it is 6c2 plus 18xc3 minus, I will keep this bracket as it is. So let's say 2x minus 1c2 plus 3x square minus 1 c3 plus 9 I have, okay. Okay, now yeah, there is one mistake as far as the sign of this one is concerned. So this sign will be eventually minus, and in fact this sign is also going to be minus because this is inside. Okay, this is inside. So if you are opening the bracket, the signs will be minus, and then this is going to be 7. 8 minus 1, 7. Okay, so if I further simplify and regroup the coefficients common to C2 and C3, I will get this as 7 minus 2x C2 from this, okay, plus then I will have here 7 minus 2x C2 from this, okay, plus then I will have here, this also is going to be minus eventually. So if I club them into the bracket, eventually I will have 1 plus 18x minus 3x square. Now how this 1 became positive? So what I have done is I have applied this minus sign inside. So minus 3x square plus 1. So that is how this plus 1 came, and then plus 18x. So minus became plus, that is plus 1 plus 18x, and this 3x square eventually became minus 3x square. Minus 3x square C3, and then I will have this constant of plus 7. So this is my residue equation. Okay, I hope you are following. Now I will have to apply the various methods. Okay, I will have to apply the various methods. So first I will apply the Galerkin method. Okay, first I will apply the Galerkin method. So I know that in Galerkin method, the weight function selection is the coefficient of Ci. Okay, coefficient of Ci. So how many coefficients I have? I have two coefficients. Okay, or rather two parameters, two unknown parameters in the equation 1. So I will select W1, that is weight function 1, as x square minus x. And weight function 2 as x cube minus x. So it is this basically what we are selecting. This is as W1 and this as W2. Okay, after satisfying all the boundary conditions. So now in a weighted integral form, okay, weighted integral form, I just have to put this inside and do the integration and eventually solve this. So what I will be doing is I will be doing this for W1 and W2 separately. So for W1, if I write it, is going to be integration 0 to 1 W1 r dx equal to 0, and similarly for W2 as well. So it is going to be integration 0 to 1 W2 r dx equal to 0. So if I put the values of W1 and r, I will have this W1 as x square minus x multiplied by r, is what we have found out in equation 2. So it is 7 minus 2x C2 plus 1 plus 18x minus 3x square C3 plus 7 dx equal to 0, and the same way for W2 as well, 0 to 1 x cube minus x multiplied by 7 minus 2x C2 plus 1 plus 18x minus 3x square c3 plus 7 dx is equal to, write it here, is equal to 0. Now we can solve this. We can solve this separately. So I'll just include one more step in between, which is integration 0 to 1. Okay, that is how you can put these values separately in the calculator. X square minus x multiplied by 7 minus 2x c2 dx plus 0 to 1 x square minus x multiplied by 1 plus 18x minus 3x square. Sorry, there is plus 7 term also. Three x square c3 dx and then plus integration 0 to 1 7 multiplied by x square minus x dx equal to 0. And same I will be doing for this as well. So here for w2 as well, I will be writing in a similar manner. So 0 to 1, let's say x square minus, not x square, x cube minus x 7 minus 2x c2 dx plus integration 0 to 1 x cube minus x 1 plus 18x minus 3x square c3 dx plus integration 0 to 1 7 multiplied by x cube minus x dx equal to 0. Now if I solve this integration separately, it is quite easy to solve this integration separately inside the calculator. And if I do that, I get these coefficients, let's say minus of 0.667 c2 minus 1.5167 c3 minus 1.1667 is equal to 0. And for the second, that is minus of 1.4833 c2 minus 2.4 c3 minus 1.75 equal to 0. So now I can solve these two simultaneous equations. Okay, and get the values of C2 and C3. Solving equation 1 and 2, we get the values of C2 and C3 as minus of 0.97 and minus of 0.129. So after getting these values, we will put these values back into equation 1. So equation 1 was minus of 0.97 x square minus x minus of 0.129 x cube minus x plus x plus 1. So now we have to find out the values at x equal to 0.3 and y at x equal to 0.6. So if we do that, the values turns out to be 1.1 1.5389 and 1.8823. So as you can see, the values are well within the domain. Okay. Now the domain means the boundaries. Okay. The domain means the not 0 and 1. The values are beyond 1. Why? Because the boundary condition says the values must be between 1 and 2. Because y at x equal to 0 is 1 and y at x equal to 1 is 2. So the values must be within 1 and 2. So the domain is between 0 and 1, but the values should be between 1 and 2. So we are getting the values between 1 and 2, and that solves the problem. Of course, we have used here two parameter solution because we have two unknown parameters remaining in the approximate function. So I hope you have understood this. Okay, I hope you have understood this. This is the Galerkin method we have done. Okay, Galerkin method, where the weight function selection is based on the constant coefficient of the constants in the equation of primary variable after satisfying all the boundary conditions. So the coefficient of this c2 was x square minus x, coefficient of this c3 was x cube minus x, and that is the reason why there were two unknown parameters remaining, c2 and c3, and that is how we get two weight functions w1 and w2. Yeah, so next up we'll see the Petro-Galerkin method. So in Petro-Galerkin, generally the weight function is selected as any function of independent variable. So what we will do, since we have to select two weight functions, we'll keep it very simple. So let's say first weight function will be x and second weight function will be x square. Okay, second weight function will be x square. So in that sense, if we solve for w1 and w2 in the same weighted integral form, so we will have 0 to 1 w1 r dx equal to 0, and for w2 similarly we will have 0 to 1 w2 r dx is equal to 0. So we will put the weight function, that is x, multiplied by the entire residue, so that is 7 minus 2x c2 plus 1 plus 18x minus 3x square c3 plus 7 dx equal to 0. This is for w1, and then what we have for w2 is 0 to 1 x square multiplied by the entire residue, so that is 7 minus 2x c2 plus 1 plus 18x minus 3x square c3 plus 7 dx equal to equal to 0. Okay, now if we solve this, okay, in the same manner, okay, we can directly get the coefficients for c2. So equation in terms of c2 and c3, so it comes out to be 2.833 c2 plus 5.75 c3 plus 3.5 equal to 0, and for second, that is w2, it comes out to be 1.833 c2 plus 4.2 plus 2.333 equal to 0. Now if we solve these two equations, okay, we will get the values of C2 and C3. So solving these two, we will get the values of C2 and C3, which comes out to be minus of 0.965 and minus 0.133. And when we will put this into the primary variable, so we will get this as minus 0.965 x square minus x minus 0.133 x cube minus x plus x plus 1. And now if we solve this for different values of x, so y at x equal to 0.3 and y at x equal to 0.6, then we get eventually the required values, which comes out to be 1.539 and 1.8827. So as you can see, the values more or less match up to two decimal places. Okay, 1.539. So up to two decimal places, the values are matching with the Galerkin method values. Okay, then we have the third method is least square method. So method number 3, that is least square method. Now we know that in least square methods, weight function is basically selected based on the partial derivative of the residue equation with respect to the constant parameter. So it is basically what, dou by dou ci of, okay, we have the entire equation, that is select the wi. So what is the residue equation over here? It's 7 minus 2x C2 plus 1 plus 18x minus 3x square C3 plus 7. Okay. Now, in order to get W1, we'll have to differentiate this partially with respect to C2. So, if I differentiate this with respect to C2, W1 will come out to be 7 minus 2x. And in order to get W2, I will have to differentiate this with respect to C3. So that will be 1 plus 18x minus 3x. So we got our W1 and W2 based on the least square approach, that is partially differentiating residue function with respect to the constant parameter. So since we have two constant parameters, again we got two weight functions, and then we can solve this for W1 and W2. Okay, so in a similar way for W1 and for W2, so it is going to be 0 to 1 W1 RDX equal to 0. So 0 to 1, I have 7 minus 2x multiplied by 7 minus 2x C3 plus 1 plus 18x minus 3x C3 plus 7 dx equal to 0. And same for the W2, so it is 0 to 1 W2 RDX equal to 0. And if I put the values, it's going to be 0 to 1, 1 plus 18x माइनस 3x2 7 माइनस 2x प्लस 1 प्लस 18x माइनस 3x2 C3 माइनस सॉरी प्लस 7 dx इक्वल टू 0. Now if I solve these integrals, I will get the values of the equation in terms of C2 and C3. So by solving this first equation, I get 36.33 C2 plus 51.5 C3 plus 42 equal to 0. So this is my equation 1, and solving this equation I get 51.5 C2 plus 99.8 C3 plus 63 equal to 0. So that is my equation 2. And when I solve these two, I finally get the values of C2 and C3, which are nothing but I just have to solve the two simultaneous equations. So the values that comes out to be minus of 0.973 and minus of 0.129. And when I put this into the equation of y, I eventually get this as minus of 0.973 x square minus x minus of 0.129 x cube minus x plus x plus 1. And when I try to find out the values at y x equal to 0.3 and value of y at x equal to 0.6, it turns out to be 1.539 and 1.883. So as you can see, this value also somewhat matches with the values which we have got by Galerkin and Petro-Galerkin method. Okay, so the only difference here was how we are selecting the weight function, and in all the methods that is only going to be the difference. The rest of the things remains the same. So after finding the weight function, you have to put it into the weighted integral form, solve for separately W1 and W2. Okay, so for W1 and W2 you have to solve separately and get the two equations in terms of two unknown parameters. Solve those two simultaneous equations, get those values of unknown parameters, put them back into the primary variable equation and get the values at the desired location. So that is what the flow of operations is going. Okay, now we will solve this by subdomain method. Now subdomain method, which is going to be the fourth method, okay, this subdomain method is very simple. In subdomain method, we know that weight functions are 1. So what we do in subdomain, as the name suggests, okay, the domain is between 0 to 1. The domain is between 0 to 1. So we divide this domain into two halves. So the first half is between 0 to 0.5 and second half is between 0.5 to 1. Okay, so we will be applying this on this particular integral form. So I have, let's say, domain division. So I have subdomains, okay. So I will say this is subdomain 1, okay, rdx equal to 0, and then I will have, let's say, subdomain 2, rdx equal to 0. Since there is no weight function, so these are my domains. Now it is required that whenever subdomain method we are dealing with, okay, we need to divide the domain into equal halves. Okay, we have to divide the domain into equal halves to get the answer. Okay, now this is by rule we are saying we tend to divide it into equal halves. Okay, and if there are three domains or if there are three unknown parameters, now how we are deciding that whether or not to divide this into two domains or three domains, three subdomains. Okay, observe the residue equation. Okay, observe the residue equation. If you go back to this residue equation finding, okay, residue equation also has two unknown parameters. So how many unknown parameters? Residue equation is having two, so that is why two subdomains. If residue equation has three unknown parameters, then in subdomain method we'll divide the domain into three subdomains. So I hope I'm clear. So then just we have to say apply the first domain limits, that is 0 to 0.5, okay, and the entire equation of R, so that is 7 minus 2x c2, okay, plus 1 plus 18x minus x square, 18x minus 3x square c3 plus 7. And this entire equation is multiplied by dx equal to 0. And for the second domain, we will be going from 0.5 to 1. Okay, so I have 7 minus 2x, then c2, then plus 1 plus 18x minus 3x square. C3 plus 7 dx equal to 0. Okay, dx equal to 0. So when I solve this, okay, I'm again going to get two equations in terms of C2 and C3. So those equations comes out to be 3.25 C2 plus 2.625 C3 equal to 0. And sorry, not equal to 0, I have the constant term as well, so that is plus 3.5 is equal to 0. And then here I get 2.75 C2 plus 6.375 C3 plus 3.5 equal to 0. So when we solve these two, I will get the values of C2 and C3, which comes out to be C2 is minus of 0.972 and C3 is minus of 0.13. And when I put these values back into the Y equation, that is primary variable equation, I get minus of 0.972 x square minus x minus of 0.13 x cube minus x plus 1. And when I find these values at y x equal to 0.3 and y at x equal to 0.6, okay, I get these as the answer. So 1.54 and 1.883. So these answers also to certain extent match with the answers which we have got with other methods, and that is what the subdomain method is. So in subdomain method, we know that weight function is 1 and we have to divide the domain into that many number of subdomains, okay, depending on the number of unknown parameters are there in the residue equation. So residue equation has two unknown parameters, so two subdomains, okay, and we are dividing it into exactly equal lengths of subdomains. So it, if my domain is between 0 to 1, I will divide it into 0 to 0.5 and 0.5 to 1 in that way. Okay. And then the last method which is remaining is the fifth method, that is collocation. Now in collocation method as well, I have weight functions equal to 1. What I do in collocation method, okay, it is not basically a weighted residual approach as well. Okay, collocation being a very simple method, depending on how many unknown parameters are there in the residue equation, we just randomly put any value of independent variable, okay, inside the residue equation. So if I have two unknown parameters okay, two unknown parameters, so depending on the any two random values within the domain, okay, we try to find out the residue at that particular point and equate it to 0. So let's say we'll select two values inside the domain, as one value will be x equal to 0.3 and the other value is going to be, let's say, x equal to 0.6. Now it is considered that you have these values fairly spread throughout the domain to get good results. Okay, but let's say again, depending on the type of differential equation that we are dealing with, okay, these results slightly vary, okay, to certain extent, but more or less any two random values within the domain should do the case for us. In my opinion, we should spread these values let's say throughout the domain. So if one value is closer to lower bound, the next value should be closer to the upper bound. Okay, instead of taking values such as 0.3 and 0.2, we can have values which are between 0 to 0.5 limit, and then 0.5 to 1 that limit. Okay, so that's what we have done over here. And now what I will be doing is I'll be just putting r at x equal to 0.3 equal to 0. Okay, and this will give me, wherever I have this residue equation, okay, I will be putting x equal to 0.3 and deriving this equation and equating it to 0. So I will get let's say I will just write it over here. So 7 minus, okay, 7 minus 2x c2 plus 1 plus 18x minus 3x square c3 plus 7. Okay, the entire thing should be derived at, let's say, x equal to 0.3 and equated to 0. That is what the meaning is, r at x equal to 0.3 equal to 0. So when I do that, okay, I get one equation, that is 6.4 c2 plus 6.13 c3 plus 7 equal to 0. And similarly, when I do this for, let's say, 0.6 for the second time, okay, I will get the second equation, that is going to be 5.8 c2, then 10.72 c3 plus 7 equal to 0. So when I will solve these two equations, again I will get the values of c2 and c3. And those values are minus of 0.972 and minus of 0.127, and that gives me y equation coming out to be minus of 0.972 x square minus x minus of 0.127 x cube minus x plus x plus 1. And when I solve this for x equal to 0.3 and x equal to 0.6 for corresponding y, I get 1.5388 and 1.882. So if you observe, closely observe, all the values are more or less matching with each other. Okay, now we are left with only one thing to identify, that is the exact solution. Okay, that is the exact solution. So that also we will do. Okay, now we will solve the problem with exact method. Okay, so exact method we are just going to solve so that we can compare the answers of this method and we can find out what is the accuracy level these methods possess. So that is the reason why we do it with such differential equations initially, which can be also solved by exact method, and we compare how these methods are performing. So the sixth method is going to be exact method or exact solution of differential equations. So now I know that the exact method is given by CF plus PI, where CF stands for the complementary function and PI stands for the particular integral. So we solve for CF initially, which is complementary function, and what we do is, okay, we keep it like this is the differential equation 3y double dash. Okay, I am writing in this particular form minus y dash plus 8 equal to 0. So now I have a constant term that is 8, okay, present. So I'll rewrite this in this particular manner, 3y double dash minus y dash is equal to minus 8. Okay, and now I will be only dealing with the left hand side part in order to find the complementary function. So complementary function, you can say, is given by forming the left hand side part or taking the left hand side part. So 3y double dash minus y dash. So now what we will do is, okay, we will take an operator d for d by dx terms. Okay, we will take an operator for d by dx terms. So d is equal to d by dx. So d square is d2 by dx square. So CF can be found out as, let's say, 3d square minus d. Okay, 3d square minus d. So basically complementary function is going to be the root of this auxiliary equation. So this is what this we have formed as the auxiliary equation. Now roots of this auxiliary equation is nothing but our CF. So I will say 3d minus 1 multiplied by d is equal to 0. Okay, 3d minus 1 multiplied by d equal to 0. So in other words, I can say d is equal to 0 or 3d minus 1 equal to 0, which in turn will give us 3d equal to 1, which in turn will give us d equal to 1 by 3, which in turn will give us d equal to 1 by 3. So now what we have got? We have got either d equal to, let's say, 1 by 3 or d equal to 0. Okay, so with this, I can rewrite complementary function as c1 e raised to 0x plus c2 e raised to 1 by 3x. Okay, c1 e raised to 0x plus c2 e raised to 1 by 3x, which I can further simplify. E raised to 0 is gonna give me 1. So I have c1 plus c2 e raised to x by 3. This is what my complementary function is. Okay, this is what my complementary function is. So this is the complementary function. Now I will have to solve for the particular integral. So for particular integral, what I do is I bring everything on the right hand side. Okay, I bring everything on the right hand side. So let's say this is the form where I have started with. So I will bring in such a way that minus 8 upon 3y double dash minus y dash. So this is going to be minus 8 upon 3y double dash minus y dash, which in terms of the operator I have already found out as minus 8 upon 3d square minus 3d square minus d. So I will have to now simplify this. So it comes out to be as minus 8 divided by, what I can do is I can separate out d from this. So d I have taken out. So 3d minus 1, d I have taken out, 3d minus 1. Now again I can get rid of this minus sign. So minus of 8, okay, I have d into, okay, I will take this 1 at the front and this 3d at the the next location. So in a way I want to write it as 1 plus or minus 3d in that way. So if I have to take it this way, because of this minus 1, so I will have to take minus 1 out. Then I can write 1 minus 3d. Okay, I will have to take minus 1 out, then I can write 1 minus 3d. Okay, so I got rid of the minus sign. So now I have 8 divided by d into 1 minus 3d. Okay, now I will have to separate these variables. Okay, so what I can do is, okay, I can take this, okay, somewhere here. So let's say this is what we want to find out. So 8d 1 minus 3d is equal to, see how I am writing, I need to separate the numerator part for these two multiplications in the denominator. So I will write as a by d plus b by 1 minus 3d. So this is what I have to find. I have to eventually find the values of a and b. So how I can find? I will simply do cross multiplication. So it is like a multiplied by 1 minus 3d, okay, plus b multiplied by d divided by the same thing which I have already got, d into 1 minus 3d. That is nothing but the left hand side, which is a divided by d into 1 minus 3d. Okay, now as you can see, there is no operator term involved here. So I have only a constant term. So how I am going to compare the coefficients in order to find the a and b values? So now I will be comparing. First I will have to open this bracket. So it is like a minus 3 times ad plus bd, okay, is equal to 8. If I am only comparing the numerators, okay, if I am only comparing the numerators, because denominators are same. So now the constant which is associated with, let's say, the right hand side is only a, because it doesn't have operator getting multiplied with it. So I can straight away write a is equal to 8. Okay, I have got one variable a which is equal to 8. Okay, now b, in order to find b, what I will have to write, okay, I will have to write minus of 3ad plus bd equal to 0, because there is no operator term. So I can rewrite this as 8 plus 0d, so that whatever term is present over here, okay, I can compare it with the coefficient of d, which is 0. Okay, now I can take d out of this. So it is minus 3 into a plus b, d equal to 0. And eventually, okay, d cannot be equal to 0 because d is operator. So what I can say is minus 3a plus b equal to 0. And in that sense, b can be equal to plus 3a, since a is already found out, which is 8. So b can be found out as 24. So now if that is done, now we have eventually separated these two things, okay, and now we have got the answer for this as, I will continue here, which is a, that is 8 by d, okay, plus 24 by 1 minus 3. Now, okay, I know that when there is only a d, that is operator, okay, differential operator in the denominator, okay, and if I have to bring it in the numerator, if I have to apply the operation onto the numerator, okay, since the differential operator is in the denominator, okay, so I have to integrate the term which is present in the numerator. So what I will do is, I will integrate this 8, okay, with respect to x, in order to solve this 1 by d term. Or in other words, I will have to integrate the 8, okay, and 1 by d means integration, okay, see the opposite of differentiation. So this will give me 8x, okay, plus I have 24, okay, I have 24 multiplied by 1 minus 3d raised to minus, okay, 1 minus 3d raised to minus 1. So this 8x plus 24, now this I have as an infinite series. So what I can do is, since it is 1 minus, so I will have to do 1 plus 3d plus 9d square plus the remaining terms. Okay, so that is how I will be doing this. So I have basically 8x. Now I will have to apply the differentials, okay, on the whatever constant that I have got outside. So now, since it is a constant, it cannot be further differentiated. So I have only one term that I can work with, that is 24. And if I try to multiply this inside, it will be 72d. Okay, but since 72 happens to be a constant, so the answer is going to come as 0. And all further terms will also give me 0 answer. So it is going to be further 0. So the final answer for PI, that is particular integral, that I got is 8x plus 24, and that gives me the complete answer, which was in terms of CF plus PR, which eventually comes out to be C1 plus C2 into e raised to x by 3. This is CF plus 8x plus 24. So this is what my y is. Now I will use my boundary condition. So my boundary conditions are what? Y at x equal to 0 is 1. So left hand side I have 1. I will use over here c1 plus c2 into e raised to 0 by 3 plus 8 into 0 plus 20. So when I do this, what I get eventually is, okay, this is gonna give me 1. So eventually it is going to be c1 plus c2 plus 0 plus 24 is equal to 1, which will eventually give me c1 plus c2 is equal to minus 23. Okay, c1 plus c2 equal to minus 23. And when I put the second boundary condition, I will write it here, when y at x equal to 1 is 2. So I have c2, sorry, on the left hand side, 2 is equal to c1 plus c2 into e raised to 1 by 3 plus 8 into 1 plus 24. So when I try to simplify this further, I have 2 is equal to c1 plus, I will have to find e raised to 1 by 3. Okay, I will have to find e raised to 1 by 3. That eventually comes out to be1.3956 c2. This is plus 8 plus 24. So eventually when I simplify this, I have c1 plus 1.3956 c2 is equal to, I have this 24 plus 8, 32. Okay, 32, when I bring in that side, so it becomes minus 32 plus 2, so it is minus 30. Okay, minus 30. So now I have these two equations, okay, in c1 and c2. I can solve these two equations, get the values of the c1 and c2, which happens to be c1 and c2 equal to, c1 is minus of 5.3053, minus of 5.3053, and c2 happens to be minus 17.6946. And when I put everything in this equation again, I have y is equal to minus of 5.3053 minus 17.6946 okay, e raised to x by 3 plus 8x plus 24. And when I find the value of this at x equal to 0.3, okay, so when I put x equal to 0.3 in this, I get the exact value of 1.5391. And at x equal to 0.6, when I find the value of y, I get it 1.8824. So as you can see, we have solved this problem by all the 5 methods, and in fact we also solved this by an exact method. Okay, by exact method. So this is all the things which we have studied so far. We have taken a second order differential equation. Okay, we solved this equation by Galerkin method, Petro-Galerkin method, then least square method, then subdomain method, and at the last collocation method. And then we also solved it by exact method. So the answers are fairly in line as compared with the exact method answers that we are getting. And you can see Galerkin method stands out to be the accurate method, okay, because the answer is going up to, let's say, 10 raised to minus 3 decimal places, okay, so 0.000, okay, and then 2, that is the error, okay, and here in terms of the second value, it is 0.0001, that is the error, okay, and if you look at the other answers, okay, here you can say 10 raised to minus 3, okay, so that is correct. Okay, here the error seems to be little more as far as Petro-Galerkin is concerned. Okay, here also the error is slightly more. Okay, it is of the order 10 raised to minus 2. So the error is substantially large in least square. Okay, then subdomain, the error is substantially large again. We have 539, so here 54. So it is 10 raised to minus 1. Okay, 1 into 10 raised to minus 1. And here again on the similar lines. Collocation 5388, okay, just on the order of, let's say, 10 raised to minus 3 error. Okay, so all the methods right about there, okay, the standout method according to this result is the Galerkin method. It gives us somewhat accurate value as compared with the exact method answer. So I hope you have enjoyed this, and this was just an attempt to demonstrate how you can work with weighted residual methods and try to solve the second order differential equations and also compare your values with exact method. So stay tuned for more such concepts. If you like whatever I am doing, okay, just hit the like button, and to get continuous updates for whatever I upload, okay, you can subscribe to my channel and please share it with others. Thank you very much. I'll see you next time.